So thank you again, Dr. Abbas. Thank you all for coming out today. It gives me great pleasure to always host these Distinguished Speaker Series events. As you can see by the individuals I have on the slide behind me, we've been very blessed and honored with some of the people that we've had here, from Richard Clark, starting our series off some 4 years ago, to Rabbi Cooper from the Simon Wiesenthal Center, who was just here this past summer. But today we have someone very special. And I want to tell you a little bit about Zach. We've been communicating back and forth now for several months. I'm really pleased that he could be here. This is going to be a different kind of talk, and thank you again for coming. Zak Ebrahim was born in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, on March 24, 1983, the son of an Egyptian industrial engineer and an American school teacher. When Ebrahim was seven, his father shot and killed the founder of the Jewish Defense League, Rabbi Meir Kahane. From behind bars, El Said Nosair was involved in the Day of Terror plot, which I have to admit, and I told Zach this morning, with all the years that I've studied this, I've never actually heard of that series of plots being referred to until today as the Day of Terror plot. It included the plot to bomb the World Trade Center. Amongst other targets, it included the Lincoln and Holland tunnels, synagogues, UN headquarters, and a number of other locations throughout New York. Ebrahim spent the rest of his childhood moving from city to city, hiding his identity from those who knew of his father. He now dedicates his life to speaking out against terrorism and spreading his message of peace and nonviolence. In 2013, he participated in TED's talent search in New York City, and was selected to speak at the main conference, TED 2014, in Vancouver, British Columbia. And I'm going to tell you, if he doesn't, of all the people invited that day to the TED talent search, his talk was ranked number one. His TED talk was released on September 9, 2014, in conjunction with his TED book, The Terrorist Son, A Story of Choice. Please welcome, and join me in welcoming, Zak Ebrahim.
I'm here today to share some stories from my life in the hopes of illustrating that no matter what path you're put on, you can choose to promote peace. Before I begin, I feel the need to explain that my story is in no way a description of the vast majority of Muslim family life, both here in America and abroad. In fact, when people take the time to interact with one another, it doesn't take long to realize that for the most part, we all want the same things out of life. A job with a decent wage, a safe environment to educate our children, and to live in a community that doesn't chastise us for our beliefs. However, in every religion, in every population, you'll find a small group of people who hold so fervently to their beliefs that they feel they must use any means necessary to make others live as they do. Being raised in the home of a Muslim zealot, I've been exposed to many of the things that people fear about Islam, yet I stand here promoting peace. This would be impossible in a world where we hang on to those old prejudices. I'm here today to dispel the stereotypes that certain politicians and media pundits attempt to project into mainstream society. I feel that I can use these experiences to combat those who would take advantage of people's fears for their own ends. Because of political opportunists who use the more radical elements of Islam to generalize the beliefs of all Muslims, but also because of extremist groups who believe that innocent victims are fair game in the ideological battleground, I feel I can speak up to balance the scales. It's a foolish mistake to believe that religious extremism is exclusive to Islam. Unfortunately, there are endless examples in every belief system of religiously motivated violence. But as a society that is supposed to value the individual freedoms afforded to us in our Constitution, it's un-American to ostracize entire communities for the actions of a few. When we ostracize the innocent, it tears apart the fabric of our society, which only works to foment the next generation of intolerance. It may come as a surprise to some that although I was raised in the religion of Islam, I am no longer a Muslim. This has little to do with my feelings on the religion itself, but rather my disbelief in an omnipotent being. I only bring that up just to point out that I'm not here advocating for any particular religious belief. I'm just here to share my stories and the lessons that I learned from them. Having said that, I would like to illustrate the path that I was put on as by my father, who for most of my life has resided in maximum security prisons. This was a special Friday for me. I was a normal six-year-old staring at the chalkboard waiting for the 3 o'clock bell to ring so that I could escape from school. But that day, my father was waiting in the hallway early. He said, "Salam alaikum," which means peace be upon you, and I replied, "Wa alaikum salam," and peace be upon you, the proper way for two Muslims to greet one another. He tells me that we're going to the mosque for Friday prayer, where the blind Sheikh Omar Abdurrahman was to preach. See, at midday every Friday, millions of Muslims around the world gather in mosques to listen to sermons given by sheikhs. The Quran, the sacred text of Islam, says that praying in a group brings you more blessings than praying alone, making Friday prayer the most blessed prayer of the week. Most clerics preach harmony between Muslims and non-Muslims, believing that there is a place in this world for all of its inhabitants to live in coexistence. The blind sheikh was not one of those men. He sat at the front of the worshippers with a microphone attached to his collar, and I sat there trying my best to mimic my father as he listened intently to the sheikh's words. That day, the sheikh argued that Western culture was corrupting Muslims all over the planet, that the consequences of Western democracy were materialism, sexual perversion, and idolatry meant to distract believers from the true word of God, laying the blame for the Muslim world's ills on many of the same groups that Jerry Falwell blamed for 9/11, pagans, feminists, and gays. But the sheikh saved his most venomous words for that of the nation of Israel. He spoke of interference and collusion by the United States and its Western allies to further their agenda at the expense of Muslim nations. He used America's support for Israel to foment the emotions of his congregation. He also spoke of the United States as using the fighters in Afghanistan during the Afghan War as a military and economic strain on the Soviet Union, and once the Soviet Union collapsed, those fighters were discarded like trash on the side of the road. Excuse me. When he finished his sermon, my father took my hand and he led me toward the front. This wasn't the first time that I had met the sheikh. In fact, I had spent more than a few nights either at the mosque or at one of my father's friends' houses or even in our own living room sitting on the floor listening to the sheikh and the other men discuss religion and politics. I realized it was always somewhat ominous exchanging words with the sheikh after one of his sermons. Looking back now that I realize, even in a room full of people vying for his attention, his mind was somewhere else, probably still wrapped with the passion and anger he clearly conveyed in his speech. On the drive home that afternoon, I wondered to myself what made the sheikh and his followers so intensely devout. I asked my father, "When did you become such a good Muslim?" And he replied, "When I came to this country and saw everything that was wrong with it." And in that instant, I saw the same look on his face that I had seen earlier on the sheikh's. Our family dynamic began to change soon after. It was during that time, at the height of the Afghan war, that I was forced to say goodbye to one of my best friends. His stepfather took him and his siblings from their home in New Jersey to Pakistan to train and eventually fight in Afghanistan. He was 10 years old at the time. Because of his inexperience, he was used to lob grenades at the enemy's occupying forces. And when he'd returned to America less than a year later, where once there stood a happy, vibrant child, now stood a solemn veteran of the Afghan War. He was a shadow of his former self, his innocence taken from him by a war he had no business being a part of. This is what happens when we use violence as a resolution of conflict. In a back-and-forth effort to gain even the slightest strategic advantage against one's enemies, man has gone to lengths that seem inconceivable to those who are sheltered from the negative effects of war. But make no mistake, humanity has shown that it's willing to exploit almost any resource, even the lives of children, all in the name of one ideology or another. Each time we resort to war, whether as a means of resolving conflict or for spreading some ill-conceived notion of freedom, we guarantee an escalation and desensitization of violence in our culture. The summer after I turned 7, my grandfather came to visit our family from Egypt. Little did he know, my father had brought him here to try and convince my father, or my grandfather, to take my family back to Egypt so that my father could go fight in the Afghan war. At the time, the United States was secretly funding the Mujahideen, the Muslim men and sometimes children who were going to Afghanistan from all over the world to fight. My grandfather's response was, absolutely not. Your family is your responsibility. If you want to make jihad, stay here and take care of them. Now, that word jihad is very interesting. If you ask the average person, what do you think jihad means, they may say that it's an act of terrorism, or that it means holy war. But that is not the definition of jihad. In reality, jihad can be something as simple as striving to live a moral and virtuous life. It's only the extremists and those who wish to generalize that reduce the word to a destructive act. And in fact, in Islam, the Prophet Muhammad specifically refers to jihad that precludes violence as the greater jihad. My grandfather went back home thinking that he had won the argument, but my father was left only frustrated and unwilling to find a non-violent outlet for those frustrations. On November 5th, 1990, when I was 7 years old, my father assassinated Rabbi Meir Kahane, the leader of the Jewish Defense League. While attempting to flee the scene, my father was also shot by a federal postal officer, and he and Meir Kahane were rushed to the hospital with similar gunshot wounds to the neck. Kahane died at Bellevue Hospital that night. My father lived. Although initially acquitted of the murder, while serving time on assault and weapons charges, my father began planning attacks on a dozen New York City landmarks, including tunnels, synagogues, and United Nations headquarters. Thankfully, those plans were foiled by an FBI informant. Sadly, the 1993 bombing of the World Trade Center was not. My father, Al-Sayed Nosair, would eventually be convicted for his involvement in the plot. A few months prior to his arrest, he sat me down and explained that for the past few weekends, he and some friends had been going to a shooting range for target practice. And he told me that I'd be going with him the next morning. To be honest, I was so excited I could barely sleep that night. And my excitement once again began to mount the next morning. We arrived at Calverton Shooting Range on Long Island, where, unbeknownst to our group, was being watched by the FBI. My father and I walked towards a group of men, and they were huddled by the trunk of a car inside were a range of weapons. When it was my turn to shoot, my father helped me hold the rifle to my shoulder and explained how to aim at the target about 30 yards off. I was so nervous, my palms were sweating. And I squeezed the trigger, my ears rang, and the noise echoed through the woods that surrounded the range, and a small notch showed where the bullet had broken through the canvas. Hearing the praise from the men around me and with my father looking over my shoulder smiling, it was my proudest moment. He seemed to be having almost as much fun as I was, if not more. Using a fully automatic weapon, he shot the legs out from under one of the larger targets, causing it to come crashing to the ground, and the men all shouted and had a laugh. But by late morning, it began to softly drizzle, and I knew our time at the range was coming to an end, so on my last turn, I took aim at the target and let each bullet fly. The last bullet hit the small orange light that sat on top of the target. And to everyone's surprise, especially mine, the target burst. And as I stood there, my uncle turned to the other men and in Arabic said, Ibn Abu, like father, like son. They all seemed to get a really big laugh out of that comment, but it wasn't until a few years later that I fully understood what they thought was so funny. They thought they saw in me the same destruction my father was capable of. Those men would eventually be convicted of placing a van filled with 1,500 pounds of explosives into the sub-level parking lot of the World Trade Center's North Tower, causing an explosion that killed 6 people and injured over 1,000 others. These were the men I looked up to. These were the men I called Ammu, which means uncle. It saddens me to think that had they not committed this crime, the innocent victims killed in the attack would be at home spending time with their loved ones. Instead, their families are forced to live their lives without their guidance and companionship. I was 7 years old when my father went to prison, and there's not a day that goes by that I don't wish he had chosen a peaceful life with his family. Instead, he exposed me from a very young age to the intolerance and radical nature of extremism. And yet I stand before you all today with this simple message, that no matter the level of violence you've been exposed to, it doesn't have to define your character, that in all of us is the ability to change our paths. I spent many years of my young life visiting him in different prisons, Rikers Island, the federal prison in Manhattan, and even entire family weekends inside of Attica State Penitentiary. I can still remember the first trip to Rikers like it was yesterday. It was a dull gray morning. My family and I had gotten up extra early to make the trip into New York City. And we piled into our old wood-paneled station wagon and started off. I remember my nervousness as we entered the Rikers Island parking lot. A light mist seemed to cut us off from the rest of the world. Because my father had been in the hospital recuperating from his wounds, it had been many weeks since I'd last seen him, and it was pretty obvious, even to a 7-year-old, that this was going to be a strange day. A bus took us across a bridge to the main facility, where we were taken into a building and frisked for any prohibited items. We were then walked down a long hallway lined with cells that provided privacy for the family's visiting inmates. A guard opened the door to one of the cells, and I saw my father sitting in a plastic chair wearing an orange jumpsuit. Then he stood up and he smiled and took his time giving me a hug. And then we sat down across from each other at the table. The first thing I noticed was the long surgical scar that ran across his chest and up his neck where the doctors had tried to remove the bullet that was lodged inside him. I remember the whole time trying not to stare at it. And while he and my mother sat in conversation, I sat wondering how his being in prison would affect our family life. That first trip was nerve-wracking, to say the least. But as the months turned into years, it all became routine to have to pass through armed guards and high fences in order to see my father. This went on for years, but eventually my mother remarried, and we decided as a family to discontinue any further contact with my father. We also changed our names so as to hide our identity from the community in which we lived. It's certainly unusual when an American citizen admits to being the son of the first member of a bin Laden organization to shed blood on American soil. Shame for what my father had done and fear for how I would be judged for his actions had caused me to hide my identity from most of those who knew me. I realized at a young age I had to be careful who I told my life story to. People's reactions had ranged from nervous laughter and shock to outright anger and threats against my life. I even once sustained a defensive wound as I tried grabbing a knife from the hand of someone I thought was a friend as he lunged at me exclaiming, "I'd be doing this country a service if I killed you." Luckily, I was able to escape without any serious injury. By the time I turned 19, I had already moved 20 times in my life. That instability during my childhood didn't really provide an opportunity to make many friends. Each time I'd meet one or two people I began to feel comfortable around, it was time to pack up and move to the next town. And being the perpetual new kid at school, I was frequently the target of bullies. So for the most part, I spent my time at home reading books and watching TV or playing video games. For those reasons, my social skills were lacking, to say the least. And growing up in a bigoted household, I wasn't prepared for the real world. I'd been raised to judge people based on arbitrary measurements like a person's race or religion. One of the major turning points in my life came when I found a summer job at Busch Gardens, an amusement park in Florida. There, I was exposed to people from all sorts of faiths and cultures and backgrounds, and it proved to be fundamental to the development of my character. I was able to contrast the stereotypes I'd been taught with real-life experience and interaction, and it didn't take long for me to realize the disservice I was doing to myself and those I was compelled to judge. Being exposed to the outside world and recognizing my own moral failings, I realized how little a person's race, religion, or sexual orientation had to do with the formation of one's character. I had a discussion not long after with my mother about how my worldview was starting to change, and she said something to me that I will hold dear to my heart for as long as I live. She looked at me with the weary eyes of someone who'd experienced enough dogmatism to last a lifetime and said, "I'm tired of hating people." And it sounds so simple, but it was so profound for me that I often fight back tears just thinking about it. It wasn't just that you could see the toll all of the result of my father's actions had taken on her, whether it was dealing with death threats or the FBI or lawyers or just being ostracized from any community that she was a part of. It was also like she was giving me permission to go out into the world and experience people unencumbered by the prejudices I had been taught. In these times of increased religious intolerance, I feel that sharing my story helps to bring greater context to the debate over religious extremism. People can become frustrated when they think one side cannot or will not understand their point of view. This is one of the reasons I promote interfaith dialogue, because I feel that it's one of the most useful tools for encouraging solidarity within our communities. And when I say dialogue, I don't mean that we pile everyone into a room to debate who's right and who's wrong. All I'm talking about is simple interaction, sharing a meal together, or working together on a community project. It not only aids in dispelling false stereotypes and prejudices, it helps to create stronger, safer communities. Opening up dialogue between different faiths can only further break down the stereotypes that we often associate with people we don't interact with very often. Fortunately, we're now seeing an increasing number of websites and literature that illustrate how you can utilize a structured form of interfaith dialogue. I really encourage everyone here to look into the different ways to foster that in your school and in your communities. For a time, I chose not to come out with my story because I was ashamed for what my father had done. But today, most times you hear about Islam or the Middle East in the news, it's usually related to some form of extremist behavior, and I knew I could use my story to combat those negative stereotypes. If I could show people that although I had been subjected to this violent, intolerant ideology, that I did not become fanaticized. That if I could choose to promote peace, then anyone can. Whenever I speak, the subject inevitably turns to groups like ISIS and what can be done to combat extremists willing to go to such brutal lengths. My answer is a relatively simple one. Don't give in to fear. That is fear, anger, vengeance. Those are the things that ISIS traffics in. And men like Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi use religion to bring people together, but it is those human emotions that keep the rank and file a part of groups like that. Like most belief systems, these ideologies cannot be destroyed with bullets or missiles. You can't bomb people into a democracy. If anything, our attempts in places like Iraq to dominate the will of a people militarily has backfired. U.S. foreign policy in the last several decades has contributed more fodder for those rallying against the United States. A generation of dead mothers, fathers, sons, and daughters has turned the men and women in our military into a common enemy for extremists and non-extremists alike. Groups like ISIS use the lack of opportunity in war-torn countries to fill their ranks. And that's where we can really make a difference. This is why we must choose peace. We live in systems designed by human beings. They're not perfect. And we have the power to change them. simply believing in something because it's what we're taught or it's just the way it is not enough. Always remember, it is not the proliferation of an idea that gives its true value, but the implications of those beliefs. One of the interesting effects of being in the public eye is that I'm never more than a few clicks away if someone wants to get in contact with me. A few years ago, I opened up my email one morning and I saw a message from the Bureau of Prisons saying that there was an inmate that would like to begin communication with me. And my first thought was, who could this be? And sure enough, it was my father. And it told me I had 10 days to decide yes or no to the communication. I knew that I wanted to be in contact with him in some way. Before I'd ever gone public with my story, I knew that I wanted to ask my father why he chose the path he did. Was it for his faith or fame? Did he feel the need to be a part of something greater than himself? If so, why wasn't his family enough? I wasn't sure if I was ready to hear his answers, but every part of me felt like I had to know. And I thought to myself, what if he died in prison and I never got this opportunity again? So I clicked yes. For the next few months, we exchanged emails back and forth, and he told me he supported my work promoting peace, and that in recent years, he too had been advocating for a peaceful resolution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. I told him about my life after he went to prison, about being poor and moving from ghetto to ghetto, the instability, being bullied, and the anxiety that manifested from those experiences. I wanted him to understand how hard it was for our family after he left, and how hard it was for my mother to keep us all together and a roof over our heads. To my surprise, my father, who for most of my life had declared his innocence, actually expressed regret. Whether it was for his actions or the effect they had on his family or his life sentence, I'm not sure. It was very difficult for me to figure out if what he was telling me was the truth or if it was just something that he was saying because he wanted to stay in contact with me. As our communication continued, though, his emails began to take on a different tone, particularly when he found that I was no longer a Muslim. He basically summed up all of the negative experiences I had as a result of his actions as it being God's plan. And as an atheist, that was not something that I was particularly interested in hearing. He even went so far as to speculate that perhaps my line of questioning was to try and incriminate him somehow. He was going through an appeals process at the time, questioning my intentions. These questions that I had had for my whole life, I think I was kind of naive in my approach. I thought that I would ask him all of these very important things that I had thought about for a very long time, and he would answer them honestly and truthfully, and I would have this moment where it all made sense. And like I said, that was a very naive thought. To say this new chapter in our conversation was disheartening would be an understatement. I stared at those last few emails, realizing that my answers would have to come from somewhere else. Because of the anxiety I'd felt having to dig up all of those old experiences, I decided once again to end communication with my father. It took me a long time to sort through all of the emotions that our conversations had brought to the surface, but in that time I realized that although not what I wanted to hear, he had actually given me the answers I was looking for. His beliefs led to a narrow and oversimplified worldview, one in which a person's religion, nationality, sexual orientation, gender, were all that was needed to determine their worth. As I mature, I realize the only way we can overcome the challenges of our past is to try and help others understand. For me, it's to help others understand that hatred only produces more hate. But belief in nonviolence at least provides an opportunity to heal. Those cycles of violence don't have to continue forever. I am not my father, And with that simple fact, I stand here as proof that violence isn't inherent in one's religion or race, and the son does not have to follow the ways of his father. And should we fulfill our obligation to live peacefully and to put in the work needed in order to obtain peace, however difficult it may be, that ultimately we will leave this earth a better place for the ones we love. Thank you very much.
Zach, that was outstanding. So before I open it up to the audience, I'm going to just ask a couple things, if I may. And when we talked earlier about profiling, and obviously there's some things happening in our country today as a result of profiling, and I mentioned to Zach that our center is involved in a foreign fighter project in Minneapolis in a Somali community. And we've met a lot of people there, particularly a lot of young men. And they all say the same thing to me. They all say, you know, you're African American, you understand what's going on. When you heard probably decades ago or years ago that a crime had happened, the first thing that goes through your mind is, God, I hope he's not black. They say now when they hear about an incident of violence, they say, I hope he's not a Muslim. So one of the things that resonated in the conversations I had with people in Minneapolis, regardless of gender, regardless of age, they all cited one activity that just runs chills through all of them, and it's airport security. And they said, the first thing they find out is my name is Muhammad or my name is Osman, and I get treated very differently. And they said, you know, why should we see something, say something, whenever we get to an airport and go through screening and we're automatically suspect? And they asked me that question, and it's a really difficult one to answer. So I'm going to ask you, dealing with young men like that, particularly young men like that, who are in a community that, as they said to me, everybody thinks I'm a terrorist because I'm a Muslim, how do we move them past that and get them to embrace their communities, support their communities, and support the country at the same time?
Well, thank you all very much, first of all. This is such a privilege to be here and to be able to take your questions, and what a privilege it is to sit next to you. Thank you. I share many of the feelings that you spoke about. Anytime I hear of any sort of violent act, whether it's a school shooting or any form of violence that takes the lives of people, my first thought is always, I hope it's not a Muslim. I'm not a Muslim anymore. I don't. But that is always my reaction. For a long time, I held certain beliefs that closed my mind to the world, to experiencing other people. Really the best way that I could answer that question would be to say that for the last 10 years, a little more than that, I've had to make a conscious effort to rid myself of the stereotypes that I had been taught, because I believed that it wasn't enough to recognize the inherent disadvantage that certain people have to deal with in airport security or in a million different ways in our society, but to recognize it and then to realize I had to be better than those who perpetuated those sorts of stereotypes. The best answer that I can give just from my experience is that since getting involved in the anti-war movement and in the peace movement, the more I interacted with people on a daily basis, the more that built on itself. For people who feel like they're being unfairly judged for their race or for any number of different ways that we find to divide ourselves, I would just say that there are many people from all different backgrounds who do not feel the way some people make you feel, and that just interacting with communities, getting involved, really builds on itself, and frankly, it keeps me going, it keeps me positive. So that would be the best way that I can answer that.
Thank you. The other item that came up often in our conversation was this notion that United States foreign policy was, in their minds, turning into a war against their religion. They spoke of the drone strikes. They spoke of issues of what we call collateral damage, where, as you mentioned, you know, families are often killed in the effort to eliminate one or two people that might be in the place at the same time. So again, along the same lines, I'd want to ask you, how do you move past that when we talk about some of our efforts overseas and some of the allies that we have and some of the things we're trying to accomplish? How do we talk to young men who are being convinced that it's in their best interest and extremely altruistic if they return home and fight for that country because they are being targeted because of their religion? What advice might you give them?
I had the incredible opportunity to speak to a group called Tuesday's Children, and they began as a group for the families of victims of 9/11 and eventually grew into the families of victims of terrorist attacks or the victims themselves from all over the world. And I had a young Palestinian man ask me a question very similar to that. How am I supposed to want to promote peace or to use a non-violent means to try and get my point across when I'm seeing my family being killed? And first of all, obviously, it's not easy. As human beings, we are often very reactionary, and when we are dealt an injustice, oftentimes we feel anger and frustration, and we want revenge. But my answer to him was, what is your goal? Is it to get that revenge, or is the ultimate goal to create a situation where people can live with one another peacefully? And I think it's important that we keep in mind the ultimate goal, that we not get lost in the human emotion that can sometimes blind us.
I want to ask you one more question before I open it up. What's the most positive experience you've had as a result of being able to speak all over about your experiences, share your book? What do you recall as being something that was just extremely fulfilling for you?
I've had so many incredible experiences since I started doing this, things that I never imagined possible. The first thing that pops into my head is I gave a speech at the Philadelphia FBI headquarters, and I finished my speech, and it was the first time no one asked me a single question afterward, which I thought was very interesting. But I finished, and some people who were in the audience came up and were just talking to me afterward, and a woman approached me, and she had tears in her eyes, and she said, "You probably don't remember me, and you shouldn't, but I'm one of the agents that worked on your father's case, and I always wondered what happened to the children of Al-Sayed Nosair." And she told me how proud she was that I was working to try and promote peace, and it was just a very emotional exchange and something that I never thought that I would get to experience, but that was incredibly fulfilling for me.
Great, thank you. Okay, so let me open it up. The first one, who is the mic I'm going to take from Isaac, okay.
Zach, you're an amazing individual, and I honor your chosen path. I know it's not easy, and you described the one instance in which your mother said, I don't want to hate anymore. Can you perhaps add some more details of the transition from youthful innocence to awareness of a better life?
Well, a lot of what I didn't talk about was that transition. My father went to prison when I was 7, and we continued to visit him, and my mother stayed married to him for many years, and he declared his innocence of all of the things that he had been found guilty of. After one day she had a conversation with him on the phone where essentially he didn't admit to it, but he said, "I did what I had to do and you knew it." And that was all she needed. It was the last straw that broke the camel's back, so to speak. And she filed for a divorce and eventually remarried. And my stepfather, unfortunately, was very abusive physically and emotionally to our family, and taught me many of the negative things that I had learned, and perpetuated many of the things that I learned when I was younger. The thing that really took me out of it, and it sounds strange, because I never would have thought about it when I was going through it, but it was the bullying. From him, from classmates, I knew so intimately what it was like to be victimized for things that were beyond my control. And when I got into a position where I was older and I wasn't a tiny kid anymore, and I could somehow dominate others, because I knew so intimately what it was like to be victimized, I realized that I didn't want to do that to other people, that I wanted to be better than the people who had caused me so much pain. And once I began to interact with the outside world, I mean, isolation is one of the most important ingredients for radicalizing someone, for turning someone into a bigot. And when I started working at Busch Gardens, I began interacting with a few of the gay dancers at a show there, and I had all these ideas in my head about what it was like to be gay, and was pretty much taught that they were all evil, and they wanted to make me evil so that I would go to hell. And I interacted with one of the dancers, and he had no reason to be kind to me or nice to me, but he was, and I couldn't bring myself to treat him badly. And that was just such an important lesson for me about empathy and about not wanting to, you know, continue the cycle, and not wanting to make people feel the way that I felt. So I would say that empathy played a very large role in that.
So before I go to Bonnie, I'm just going to say, again, I am going to promote Zak's book. He's sharing some incredible moments that are written very eloquently in the book about the path, and it was really a text that I just couldn't put down. It was incredible. So, Bonnie, please.
Zak, I also want to thank you for your courage and for using your life experience and your voice for peace and for nonviolence. So, thank you.
Thank you.
I'm curious a little bit about the family dynamics, because it's obviously fascinating. You talk the first 6 years of your life, your dad coming after school, it's when you're 6 years old. Talk a little bit more about your mom. Did she support these? Because you said that dad had many discussions at the house all the time. Did your mom support those views being discussed in the home? Did your mom have extended family, cousins, and others? The broader family dynamic, and you mentioned the FBI agent said, I wondered what happened to his children. So do you have siblings, and what's their path been?
Thank you. Wonderful questions. Shortly before my father went to prison, the majority of the things that were discussed in our house were related to the war in Afghanistan, which for my mother, who was raised Catholic in the United States of German and Austrian heritage, she found that war was supported by the United States government. So it wasn't something that she saw as, what's the term? I'm drawing a blank, but just that it wasn't something that went against her beliefs or her nationality as an American. And for me, many of the lessons that I held on to were the ones that she taught me about not judging a book by its cover and treating people the way you want to be treated. Her introduction to this ideology that my father had, or this path that my father had taken, she was watching television the night of the Kahane assassination, and her show was interrupted by breaking news saying that Meir Kahane had been shot and so had his assailant, and neither were expected to live, and they showed video of my father laying in a pool of blood in the street. And that was essentially her introduction to this lifestyle that he had chosen. Because of the instability, because we moved around so much, when my siblings and I talk about it today, we can't really understand how she was able to keep us together. And I knew my whole life that even when she didn't make the best decisions, they were always done in our best interests. She was doing her best. So many of the things that I held on to when coming out of this bigoted belief were the lessons that she had taught me. which I'm incredibly grateful for, and I tell her all the time, and she talks about how proud she is of me because of what I'm doing, and she cries, and I just explain to her that this would be impossible without her. Beyond just the lessons that she taught me, she was a teacher, and she instilled in me from a very young age a love for reading that I think has allowed me in some way to be able to communicate what I, you know, how I feel to an audience, and I just, you know, thank her all the time for that. As far as my siblings, I have a brother and a sister, and they're both incredibly supportive as well of the path that I've chosen. They've decided to keep their lives private. Younger brother, older sister. I'm the middle child. But they're very supportive. And before I ever decided to start speaking publicly, I wanted to make sure that I had their support, because obviously it was a big deal to have to talk about all of this. And it was an experience that all of us shared, so it was very important to me. No, they divorced a very long time ago, thankfully.
Yes.
Thank you, too. And I have two questions. One, did your mother convert to Islam?
She did. They met the night that she converted, actually. She was at the mosque. My father was in a prayer study, and the person that was helping her through the process of converting asked if she would mind doing it in front of this group of men, because, you know, they always love to see a new convert become Muslim. Mm-hmm. And she... It's funny because her first act as a Muslim was to steal a peek at my father, who she thought just looked so Egyptian and had these green eyes. And so, yeah, they met the night that she converted.
Mm-hmm. So I guess the question, I wanted to know, are you invited much to speak before Jewish audiences? And if so, what is the reaction that you get?
The reaction varies depending on, you know, the makeup of the group. But I've had the great privilege of speaking at synagogues and in front of largely Jewish audiences. Frankly, the support that I've had from the Jewish community has helped me in incredible ways. And there are so many people in the community who helped me. From a very early time, and supported me and the message that I was speaking about.
Yes, next. Sure.
Thank you, Zach. That was really lovely, and it's
thank
so
you.
Heartwarming to hear this story and sharing it with us. We appreciate it.
Thank
I
you.
I have a couple
much.
Of questions. I'm an economist, and I've been particularly interested in ways to cross to one's enemies in a way that with incentives that to make it work. And I'm wondering, in your reaching out, are you, I mean, a lot of it sounds very personal, and that's kind of maybe your approach. You're personally speaking to the Jewish community or to some other community or maybe to Muslim communities. But are there things that you can see where if you could establish some, you seen any success stories of where there are incentives to kind of work together? I mention that because one of the things I've been working on is business relations between Israelis and Palestinians, or Jordanians, and under what circumstances does that sort of lead to some cooperation and movement? And I wonder if you could share where this reach out that you do or you see in others, what
sure.
sort of leads to success?
You know, I've been very lucky that I've gotten to, in a sense, ride the coattails of community members all over the country who are working on projects that bring people who generally don't interact with one another together, specifically for the purpose of you know, trying to create a stronger community. And I think that there are countless examples here and around the world of that working. I have had conversations with people who had very similar upbringings to mine, were raised in very extremist households, and felt that sharing their story could bring people closer together. I think, you know, just as you said, you know, working together to bring Israelis and Palestinians, or Israelis and Jordanians together, you know, with the incentive to create a stronger economy, you know, is one way of doing it. You know, I just I've seen so many, in so many different ways, how just interacting with one another can humanize, you know, each other and each other's side, in a way that few other things can. You know, that's why I've been promoting interfaith dialogue for so long, because it's really, you know, having a potluck in a, you know, in a universalist church with people of a whole bunch of different backgrounds is, you know, can be a lot of fun, and you learn a lot too, so.
Okay, let's take one more.
Yes, in the back.
I wanted to know, I agree with your idea of interfaith dialogue, and I think that that's a beautiful concept. And I think that it's something that can be easily attained here in the United States, but how do we approach having that as a part of the international community, and specifically in the Middle East? And does the United States have any sort of responsibility to get involved in that, or do we just withdraw and focus on our own country and promoting interfaith dialogue here? Or because we have this mentality, or you're spreading this, do we try spreading it abroad too? Is that, what are your views on that?
Well, there are lots of organizations that are built for the specific purpose of trying to bring people, particularly in the Middle East, particularly in Israel and Palestine, bringing people together. Adults, children, Seeds of Peace is an organization that brings, that has summer camps where Israeli and Palestinian children can interact with one another. You know, I certainly think that it works and it exists. You know, for the United States to withdraw and not interfere would kind of be, from my understanding, the opposite of what we've been doing for a very long time. So I don't think that that's very likely. Oh, thank you all very much. Really, such a privilege.
It always gives me a great pleasure when we have these events. I want to thank all of you for coming and supporting us. Zach, this was absolutely incredible. So I'm really privileged when I get to do this, and especially today, because not only is this Zach's first trip to USC, it's his first trip to Los Angeles. So, Zach, I want to thank you. If you'll come on up here, I want to thank you for coming today. I want to thank you for sharing your story, sharing your life, being an incredibly amenable person to this. You know, I just do what I always do. I just called him up, and the conversations were great. We got him here, and more people should hear your story. Thank you for what you do. Thank you for going on this path. And on behalf of CREATE and the university, we'd like to give you a small token of our appreciation.
Thank you very much. Thank you all.